write a blurb for the back of the book, because they know his fan club has 5,000 members, and that's a lot of books to sell. He read it and he wrote back and he said, frankly, I did not care for the book, because he calls Godzilla cheesy 17 times. And that was generally the response that I got, that in many ways, fan communities felt, first, they didn't know enough about Godzilla, and second, I attacked Godzilla, you know? Fan communities have a sort of a low tolerance for criticism of, you know, what they think so highly of. And whereas for me, saying the Godzilla films is cheesy, that's part of their appeal to me. That's what one of the things that makes them great, it makes the series so significant over time. To many people, that was a turnoff. So I've actually written an article about my experience of writing this book and the response I got. I don't know if you've seen this.
I'll post it for the class. Yeah. What is it called?
Godzilla versus the Egghead. And it was in the Journal of U.S.-Japanese Relations. It really was, what was interesting, I mean, this is before the internet became the kind of toxic sphere that it is now. Nonetheless, back in 2004, it was toxic enough. When you see some of the comments that people posted online in forums about this, it's disturbing but also amusing. It's a great, to me I wrote it as sort of something for other academics about the pitfalls, but also the joys of writing for a public audience. Well, thank you all so much for being here today. It's a real pleasure. I want to thank Professor Friedman for the invitation and the hospitality. And I want to thank Holly. Where are you, Holly?
Holly, so much for getting me here last night, which was not the easiest thing in the world. She was probably sitting at her desk, packed up her belongings to go home when I called and said, help!
And I started panicking.
But she got it all done. Now, sometimes I think I have spoken to every single audience in the world about every possible aspect of Godzilla you could ever imagine. By my count, I've given more than 100 presentations on the King of the Monsters over the past decade, from rural elementary schools in Kansas to colleges and universities, from Hawaii to South Carolina to Vermont, at numerous Japan festivals and anime conventions, at Rotary clubs and retirement homes and reading groups and TEDx events in Alaska and Finland and in Little Rock. I briefed executives at Marubeni Corporation, which is one of Japan's big global trading firms, in a skyscraper in New York City about the importance of Godzilla. I once addressed a sea of soldiers with shaved heads at Fort Riley in Kansas. About 2,000 people were forced to remain silent as I talked to them about Godzilla at an Asian American History Month lecture. I once gave a talk on Godzilla to every ninth grader in a big Kansas City suburb, 1,800 15-year-olds over the course of the day. And let me tell you, they did not stay quiet during my talks. I spoke many years ago to a gray and lifeless room filled with IRS employees. This too was an Asia Pacific Islander Heritage Month event. And the most real part of that was, after talking to the IRS about Godzilla, they gave me my honorarium in an unmarked envelope in cash. My two most electrifying performances were at G-Fest, which is the world's largest Godzilla convention, which is held every July in Chicago, and it is worth attending if you have any interest in fandom, because it is quite an intriguing event. I spoke on my book in a large ballroom in a Chicago hotel to a very raucous crowd, and for one of the short periods of my life, I actually felt like a rock star very briefly. The other place that I really enjoyed speaking on Godzilla, which is unexpected, was at the fourth triennial international Mosasaur conference. Mosasaurs are dinosaurs, sea dinosaurs. And so this was a group of archaeologists and really paleontologists who specialize in ancient sea dinosaurs. And it turns out there's one group of people that love Godzilla even more than me, and it's these paleontologists who've all seen all the movies and can talk about them in these weird scientific ways. But I can't tell you how pleased I am finally to be speaking here. It's my first time to speak on Godzilla in Oregon, and this is my 26th state overall. So I can spread the good word of the King of the Monsters to you all today. Now I hope that for starters, everyone in this room will agree with me, just by the fact that you're here today, that Godzilla has real significance. Not just to hardcore fans, not just to scholars of Japanese popular culture, but for anyone seeking insight into post-war Japanese history or the emergence of Japanese soft power or the global circuitries of pop icons and inspirations. One of my admissions counselors at Hendrix recently told me the story of a prospective student who was applying to the college. And it heard about my interest in Godzilla and my office filled with Godzilla toys and the Godzilla nativity scene, which I display every Christmas in my office, and the Godzilla cake, which I had at my inauguration a couple years ago. But this family was somewhat confused. How can your president have written three books about a monster who doesn't even exist? My first thought, of course, was to pity these poor, ill-informed people. Didn't they know that Godzilla had been the subject of more New Yorker cartoons than even that most Gotham of monsters, King Kong? Did they not know that North Korean dictator, film buff, and jumpsuit model Kim Jong-il was a massive fan of Godzilla and even made his own giant monster movie, the spectacularly bad Pulgasari, in 1985? Had they not even heard of Monster Island? Heck, I think Carnival Cruises makes calls there now. A while back, I was talking to one of the physics professors at Hendrix, and I asked him about his research. He told me that he worked on dark matter. We all know it exists, he explained, but we just can't prove it yet. Oh, I replied, you mean like Bigfoot? Now, needless to say, I could just as easily have said, you mean like Godzilla. Because to me, in a very real way, though Godzilla is a fictional character, his impact on the cultural lives of us all make him very, very real indeed. So Godzilla, I will say at the start, is real, and Godzilla is important. Let me start then with a classic short film, one that taps into that deeper, greater significance of the King of the Monsters. Now, in November of 2014, Godzilla turned 60 years old. gets a big guy as a card-carrying member of AARP. He gets big discounts at Denny's. Most of his scales have turned gray. Indeed, just for the record, Godzilla was always gray, not green as he is usually portrayed in the media. And over those 6 decades, Godzilla has starred in 31 movies, 29 made in Japan by Toho Studios, the most recent appearing just a few months ago here in the United States, and 2 in Hollywood, including the 2014 release by Legendary Pictures and Warner Brothers. And indeed, Godzilla star seems to be on the rise again. For a decade after 2004, Godzilla was on hiatus. Toho Pictures in Japan put him on the shelf, didn't make or license any movies, but in recent years, Godzilla stock has truly been soaring. Thanks to the popularity of the legendary film in 2014 and the success of the 2016 movie, especially in the Japanese domestic market, where it did extraordinarily well. So at present, there is another Toho film under in planning. There are 2 more films from Legendary Pictures in some stages of development, including one that pits Godzilla against his old nemesis King Kong again. And there is a full-length feature anime based on Godzilla being made in Japan as well. Thus, now seems like a really great time to reflect on Godzilla. What's the deal with this overgrown radioactive lizard that seems to love nothing better than destroying Tokyo? Why does this cinematic monster continue to stir our imaginations and attract audiences? Why do fans like myself, almost 10 years younger than Godzilla, still enjoy watching an actor in a rubber suit stomping the heck out of toy cities? First of all, though, let's talk about some basic facts and figures. When was Godzilla invented and under what circumstances? Well, if we go back to 1952, the American classic film King Kong, originally made in 1933, was re-released. In fact, King Kong was re-released globally at this time, and it proved very popular in Japan. The next year, Warner Brothers came out with a film called The Beast from 20,000 Fathoms. This is about a brontosaurus that swims up the Hudson River to spawn and ultimately is barbecued alive in Coney Island. This, too, was well received internationally, including in the Japanese market. And this implanted into the mind of Japanese filmmakers the idea of giant monster movies. They saw how successful Hollywood's product had been, and they thought we could copy that formula and make some money. The mid-1950s were, of course, something of a golden age for giant monsters internationally. One of the biggest grossing films in America in 1954 was this beauty, which you might recognize, Them. Okay. And there were other classic features of the time, including The Deadly Mantis, Tarantula, and Beginning of the End, all inspired by mounting Cold War tensions and Middle America's countless anxieties and neuroses of that time. Now, Godzilla's genesis, as we discussed in the class earlier this morning, was also very much ripped from the headlines and conditioned by the political news of the day, superpower politics and atomic age fears. So in March of 1954, a Japanese fishing vessel called the Lucky Dragon No. 5 strayed into the U.S. nuclear bomb testing zone near Bikini Atoll. The crew was exposed to massive amounts of radiation. One crew member subsequently died from this exposure, and some of the radiated tuna on the ship made it back onto the market in Japan. At that point in time, with the Cold War tensions, what they were, the United States never acknowledged nuclear tests, so they denied that the Lucky Dragon incident had been caused by an American H-bomb. They publicly stated that perhaps it was food poisoning that had sickened the sailors, and there never was a public apology from the American government for this incident. Needless to say, this was huge news in Japan and the media at the time. It was called the latest atomic bombing of Japan. And of course, it was huge news because tensions ran so high in Japan and wounds were still so raw because it was less than a decade after the atomic bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Remarkably, the ship involved in this affair, the Lucky Dragon number 5, was preserved by the city of Tokyo, and you can see it in a museum there. I happened to be there on the 60th anniversary of the bombing of Nagasaki, and I'm sad to say I was the only visitor to the museum that day. It is not easy to get to, and most people have forgotten how significant at the time this event was. But it is really, as you know, it's extraordinarily moving to be there. And this is my favorite part of it. Do you remember this? This is the monument to the tuna that were radiated. And it really is the form of an apology because they died a senseless death, because no one ended up eating them. And so it is just, it's just quite a beautiful, beautiful, touching thing there. Now, Godzilla, it is said, was the brainchild of a producer at Toho Studios. Toho is one of Japan's big movie houses. A guy named Tanaka Tomoyuki. The story goes that Tanaka had been down in Indonesia making a blockbuster picture. He was flying back to Japan over the South Pacific. He was thinking about the headlines of the day, the Lucky Dragon incident. He was thinking about the success of American giant monster movies, and he had one of those great light bulb moments. What if a huge monster rose out of the ocean and attacked Tokyo? When he got back, he recruited some top talent in the Japanese film industry for his picture, since he intended from the start for Godzilla to be a serious film. Okay. So for special effects, he recruited someone named Tsuburaya Eiji. Tsuburaya was a legend already at that time in Japanese special effects circles. He was by far the master in Japan and went on to become a global legend for his work on things like Ultraman. But he had learned during World War II the skills of making special effects using miniatures. Doing the work he was doing, he weren't making propaganda films for the Japanese military during the war, and by recreating things like the attack on Pearl Harbor using extraordinarily detailed miniatures, he had honed his skills, skills that would come in perfectly in making that original Godzilla movie. For director, Tanaka chose a guy named Honda Ishiro. And Honda's the one on the left here, just so you know. Honda went on to have a very, very distinguished career in Japanese cinema. He was an assistant director for the great Japanese filmmaker Kurosawa Akira. He worked with him on some of his most famous films, including Ran and Kagemusha. But at that time, he was fairly recently demobilized from the Japanese army. He had served in China during World War II. When he came back to Japan after the war, as was customary for many Japanese being repatriated, he was brought through Hiroshima. And the American authorities during the occupation did this on purpose to underline for those coming back from the Japanese Empire how thoroughly defeated Japan had been. Honda very much got the message. He was a committed pacifist. When he saw the devastation in that city, he said, this can never happen again. So he brought that passion with him when he made this film. And he intended it to send a very, very strong political message. As is now well known, the origins of the name, it's a portmanteau word, a combination of two Japanese words, gorira, which means gorilla, and kujira, which means whale. Squished together, they became gojira. The rumor is that this was a cruel nickname given to an overweight and somewhat sweaty worker at Toho Studios, that Tanaka heard the nickname and liked it. But in an interview given long after his death, his widow said, in fact, it probably was made up at a committee meeting. And that sounds right for Japan. Now, Toho Studios invested a lot in Godzilla, about three times the budget of the average Japanese film of the time, although one should note, far less than Hollywood would have spent on a very run-of-the-mill B-movie at that juncture. The film opened on November 3rd, 1954 in Tokyo. Box office receipts were strong. In fact, at the time, it set the record one weekend box office in Japan. And its success was such, especially its potential appeal to international audiences, that soon an entire Godzilla franchise was born. Now, how Godzilla came abroad is deserving of a great deal of attention in and of itself, but I'll just mention briefly that first globalization of Godzilla, which was in the film Godzilla, King of the Monsters, which appeared in 1956. As many of you know, this was a cleverly re-edited version of the Japanese original, with the addition of Raymond Burr, who was pretty much the cheapest talent that they could afford at the time, as an American reporter in Tokyo who voyeuristically observed the destruction of the city by this giant monster. The distributors who imported the original Japanese Godzilla to America had a real quandary. Okay, what are we supposed to do with this film? If we subtitle it, well, that limits its audience considerably. It really only goes into art house theaters, okay, where the elite will watch it and see it as this artistic product from abroad. But really, you know, a movie with a big monster destroying a city, that's more for a mass audience, okay? But if we dub it, then it seems like a kiddie film, okay? And we're not going to capture that top end of the spectrum. So what they tried to do was split the difference. And what they ended up doing was really, really very clever. If you watch the Japanese original, then you watch Godzilla, King of the Monsters, it is hard not to be impressed with the job of reconstructive surgery they did on that Japanese film. They sliced and diced, they added new footage with Raymond Burr, and they created in this version a passively tight giant monster action picture. Unfortunately, as has been noted many times, in the process of making it, they edited out a lot of the most provocative and interesting content from the original, to the extent that one could say it was censored in coming to the United States. So all mentions or nods towards World War II were either taken out or downplayed. Mention of atomic weaponry also came out. It essentially was sanitized for American audiences, who the distributors felt were too sensitive to endure any criticism of America at this time during the Cold War. One of the interesting facts about this was, so we started the Japanese movie, 1954, sliced, diced, Raymond Burr eyes for 1956 in the American market. Subsequently, the Raymond Burr version is subtitled in Japanese and released in Japan, where it does almost as well as it did the first time through. And this to me is an example of sort of long-standing Japanese peculiarity of only really recognizing the success of something they have done when it is acclaimed abroad. You know? That because Hollywood and American audiences saw something interesting in Godzilla, well, maybe they should see something more interesting in Godzilla than they had the first time around. I was asked once by someone if the Japanese audiences really wanted a version without the politics as well. That if they wanted to see a scrubbed down version too, then maybe, and that might be the case. It might be there was an audience that wanted that serious movie in 1954, and there might be an audience that wanted a slightly less serious, more action-oriented version in 1956. Now the first 15 films in the franchise are known collectively as the Showa series, after the reign name of the Showa Emperor, Emperor Hirohito. They appeared between 1954 and 1975. At that point, really, the series had sort of run out of steam, creatively, financially, and so forth. Subsequently, though, it was brought back. Seven more appeared in the 1980s to the early 1990s, known as the Heisei series, Heisei being the reign name of the current emperor of Japan. That series ended with 1995's Godzilla versus Destroyer, in which Godzilla very famously died of an internal meltdown, a kind of radioactive heartburn that ate him from inside. A third run of Japanese movies then began in 1999 with the film Godzilla 2000 Millennium, and ended with a 50th anniversary blockbuster called Godzilla Final Wars, which premiered in Los Angeles in 2004, but which regrettably proved a disappointment to just about everyone, fans and the larger market alike. As we discussed, TriStar produced a lamentable knockoff of Godzilla in 1998, and I know there might be some folks in this room who grew up with this movie and feel differently about it than I do. It starred Matthew Broderick and featured a Jurassic Park-like dinosaur with a bad case of postpartum depression running around Lower Manhattan after dropping a mess of eggs in Madison Square Garden. Fans of the Japanese Godzilla series often refer to the TriStar monster as Gino, Godzilla in name only. I think the less said about this manifestation of the monster, the better for me. Now, as you all may know, the original film back in 1954 was indeed very serious and somber. The basic story is this, and if you haven't seen it, I encourage you to do so. It really is, in my mind, a classic. A mysterious creature is found to be disrupting shipping and terrorizing a small island to the south of Japan's main islands. Japanese scientists are sent to investigate, and they find that it is a surviving dinosaur from the ocean, rendered huge and monstrous by South Pacific nuclear weapons testing. The monster then, inexplicably, and this is one of the great mysteries of the series, why is the monster drawn to attack Japan and Tokyo in particular? The monster then sets its sights on the Japanese capital city, laying waste to Tokyo in a series of horrifying nighttime raids. Ultimately, though, the monster is stopped by a secret weapon, the oxygen destroyer, which is developed by a noble Japanese scientist who kills himself and then takes the fearsome secret of his super weapon with him to his grave in order to rid the world of Godzilla. And I will tell you, I often tell audiences, I'll tell you this as long as you promise never to tell my wife, the best day of my life was the day I saw the original prop for the oxygen destroyer. It was in a museum in Kawasaki. They did a display on the Godzilla films, and they had the prop there. And you know how sometimes you're in a museum and you're really tempted just to steal something? It was awesome. Now, the original Godzilla was a dark, thoughtful, and politically charged movie. It was filled, in my watching of it, with implicit criticism of the United States, also of the unfettered nuclear testing of the Cold War era. It really played upon the fears and anxieties of the Japanese audiences that were watching. It really evoked the lingering traumas of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, as well as the firebombings of World War II. And this scene of Tokyo after Godzilla's attack. I think this was not a neutral scene to Japanese audiences in 1954. This was very real. This was very close to them. And so they responded emotionally. I had long heard that audiences in Japan in 1954, when they saw the film, often left movie theaters in tears. And I never knew what to make out of that until after I'd written my book, I got a very nice letter from a person who said he'd been in the U.S. Air Force stationed in Japan in the 1950s, and he had gone to a Japanese theater on a date to watch this movie. And he could confirm to me that, in fact, the day that he went, people were crying at the end of the movie. And I thought that was, I appreciate him writing to me, and was great evidence to show that. And to me, this is, if you're going to watch one Godzilla movie, watch that. Now, after that classic 1954 original, as many of you know, the quality of the series honestly declined pretty rapidly. The serious message of that first offering was speedily junked. The first sequel came out in 1955, and it was pure action picture all the way. More crowd-pleasing fare became the order of the day, and the age of the target audience for these films steadily declined. The 1954 film aimed at adults, okay, aimed at serious cinephiles, film viewers. By the 1960s and 1970s, it was aimed clearly at 7 and 8 year olds. Okay, this reflected changes in the Japanese movie-going public. Right, in the 1950s, movies were the means of entertainment. By the 1960s and 1970s, television had largely displaced actually going to the movies as a main way people amused themselves, and so the only predictable audience left for Japanese movie producers was children, and that's who Toho was aiming at. The films really degenerated at this time into big-time wrestling in rubber suits, a process which Toho proclaimed as suitmation. And the scripts and special effects were remarkably cheesy, and yet at the same time, from my viewing at least, also quite appealingly campy. Who couldn't laugh at the King of the Monsters teaching his son how to blow radioactive smoke rings, flying on his tail, or as in this one, Godzilla versus the Sea Monster, playing volleyball using a huge boulder with a giant mutant lobster? Now note that one of the most interesting facts about Godzilla movies during the 1960s and early 1970s was a lot of the production crews that made Godzilla movies at this time and the directors who were hired for these films had previous experience in the pornographic film industry. Okay. Why would that be relevant, do you think? Well, the makers of the Godzilla films realized that in order to keep these youth audiences engaged, in order to keep 7 or 8 year olds in their seats and watching the screen rather than fighting in the aisles and throwing things, you had to have some kind of action every 60 to 90 seconds. And interestingly, the audience for pornographic movies had that same demand. Okay? Short attention span theater was the order of the day. And so these were people who specialized, you know, there had to be a lot of fight scenes in these movies. Now, the Heisei series of the 1980s and 1990s was intended to be more serious, to take Godzilla back for adults. They generally had better production values, but most of the scripts were still weak, and the acting was astonishingly poor at some points if you watched these films. The movies released after 2000, that Millennium series, in my opinion, are generally quite strong. With very much improved screenplays and some truly memorable fight sequences, but many fans still criticize them for a lack of creativity and a continued pandering to preteen audiences. One thing people often point to is many of those films made after 2000 were released as double bills in Japan, and they were shown together with films like Hamtaro. Okay, so if you're showing a Godzilla movie with a hamster cartoon, you know, it gives you a message as to what kind of audience they were going for with these. Now, the 2014 Legendary Pictures reboot of the series, directed by Gareth Edwards, really breathed new life into the franchise, I believe. I like the film, and I will tell you here, I take full credit for its success. Though that credit has not been generally acknowledged yet, okay? About 6 years ago, I was at my desk in Dallas, and I got an email. And it said, "Hi, you don't know who I am, but I'll tell you, I'm working on a secret Godzilla project. You will see it in the media in a few months' time. I just want to assure you of one thing. I and the other folks working on this project have read your book."
We understand what you say in there, and we want to create a Godzilla that is true to the Japanese original. 2 weeks later, I get another email that says, hi, you don't know who I am. That's another name. And he says, but I just want to tell you, I loved your book, and we're taking it seriously. So I watched the news, I don't know who these guys are. Turns out one of them is the person who wrote the story, the original story for the Legendary Pictures film, and the other one was the original producer for the original film. Okay? So as soon as I realized that, I'm back on the email to them, hey, I want tickets for the opening. Never heard from them again. And in fact, there were creative differences later on today that in the lawsuit of Legendary Pictures. Nonetheless, I'm glad to know that there is, you know, sometimes, you know, the things you do have an impact. And if there's any way in which what I wrote helped make that a better movie, I am proud, proud of you. Now, while the Legendary Godzilla is by no means perfect, one of my great aspirations in life was to write something for the journal Foreign Affairs. Of course, it was about Godzilla. They finally asked me to write something. I do have a review of this movie in Foreign Affairs to get my sense of it. I feel it managed to combine some of the best of the Japanese series, the spirit of Godzilla, especially a heroic monster, a monster with a sense of personality, with the strengths of early 21st century Hollywood action filmmaking. It is a fun film to watch, but it also has some of that substance of the series. The 2016 Toho reboot, Shin Godzilla, opened in Japan in July 2016, was very, very successful at the Japanese box office. Surprised everyone by how successful it was. It featured some very popular stars, but it was also very, very timely. And subsequently had a limited release in the United States last fall. It was directed by a well-known veteran of the Japanese anime industry, Anno Hideaki. And Shin Godzilla, and the meaning of it, you'll notice here, those of you who read Japanese, right, Shin is rendered in kana rather than in kanji. So this Shin can mean a lot of different things, okay? It can mean new, it can mean true, it can mean pure, it can mean God, Godzilla. So it leaves a lot of room for us to imagine what this monster is supposed to represent. This new film really harkens back very effectively, I think, to the start of the Godzilla franchise, both in having a serious political message, this time about the need for generational change in Japanese politics, for a reevaluation of Japan's government leadership. And also, it is much like that original 1954 film in being a very talky picture. One of the things that surprises people watching the original Godzilla is the monster's only on screen for a very short period of time. The reason for that is it was really expensive and hard to make those monster sequences. Those took a lot of work. So they had to fill that in with this sort of love triangle story and debates over what to do with the monster and so forth. The new Godzilla movie is very much like that. The monster sequences are fairly limited, and there is a whole lot of committee meetings around it otherwise. And also, alas, I hate to say, it seems that Suitmation has gone the way of the dodo. Shin Godzilla is full-on CGI. And New York Times did a nice article, I think it was over a year ago, about the disappearance of the special effects specialists and staff that could make traditional man-in-the-rubber suit movies and television series. What was, in the time, very cost-effective in Japan back in the 1950s, labor was cheap. And so having a very labor-intensive process, like making miniatures for guys in suits to destroy, worked for them. Today, of course, labor is incredibly expensive in Japan. This process is very finicky. It takes a lot of hands to make the sets. It frankly is not economical anymore. So simply, it has died out in Japan. The specialists who make those kind of films no longer exist, and so it appears that Godzilla is going to be the creation of a computer from now on. And I'd be interested later on when we get to the questions to hear your impressions, those of you who've seen the 2014 and 2016 films,
how you feel about them and how you feel Godzilla is being reinterpreted today. So then, given this somewhat checkered past, and given the general reputation which Japanese monster movies have long held as low-quality, insubstantial, kiddie entertainment, why has Godzilla proved so consistently popular across the years, indeed across the decades? And let me just throw out a few ideas for you, and you can add to these as we go along. First, the films have remained topical. Over time, they took on a wide array of timely themes that were of concern in Japanese society. The Cold War, nuclear testing, memories of World War II, and vulnerability in international relations during the 1950s. In the 1960s, they addressed government corruption, the rising influence of large corporations, consumerism, and the blossoming of a mass market economy. Again, issues very much at the forefront of Japanese life at that time. In the 70s, it was pollution and environmental issues, urbanization, the counterculture, and even issues like school bullying. It's hard to imagine there was a Godzilla movie focused on school bullying, but there was, okay, back in the 70s. The benefits and costs of economic prosperity, generational change, nationalism, controversies regarding Japanese remilitarization, and the challenges of globalization really became central to the series from the 1980s up to the present day. The 2014 American film very much continued in this tradition of being topical. It looked at Japan, at Godzilla, in the context of natural disasters. And if you think about that movie, you will see it's almost a catalog of natural disaster references, from the San Francisco earthquake to Hurricane Katrina to Fukushima and 311. The 2016 Toho version not only evoked the 311 triple disaster, but also addressed long-standing concerns about the political dysfunctionality of Japan's top political leadership. So this is the classic scene from the new Godzilla movie, right? You know, it's not a monster rearing over Tokyo. It's a guy, it's a bunch of guys in jumpsuits sitting at a conference table. So topicality, I think, is one reason the movies have remained relevant. Second, Godzilla as a character has remained remarkably flexible, able to adapt to shifting markets and changes in the zeitgeist of post-war Japan and the world. Godzilla could go with the flow, addressing the needs of a wide range of movie audiences. So thus, Godzilla became more Muppety, to be funny and appealing to children. The monster got larger as Japanese skylines grew, and then got even larger when it came to Hollywood in 2014, and then grew even a bit more in 2016. The tone of the films changed based on the tone of the times. So in the 1960s, when Japan was in a very upbeat era economically and nationally, the films were more lighthearted. Godzilla was more a defender of Japan than an enemy of Japan. And since the 1990s, most of the films have been more somber. Of course, that reflects the changes in Japan since the collapse of the bubble economy, and we're now known as the lost decades for the nation. Now third, the fact that Godzilla is effectively unaging helps explain some of his long-term staying power as a celebrity. Godzilla is constantly refreshed as new latex suits have been churned out by the folks at Toho. And thus, Godzilla really avoided the ravages of time and mortality. And his fans were spared the indignities of Fat Elvis, Labor Day Telethon Jerry Lewis, or Pierce Brosnan as 007. And of course, I do at this point have to mention controversies over the weight of the 2014 Godzilla. So back in 2014, I was in my car, and I got a call from my assistant, and she said, "Yahoo News is on the line, and they said it's an emergency." I said, "Yahoo News is on? An emergency from Yahoo News?" I said, "This is too good. Put them through." Okay.
So I'm talking to someone who's clearly an intern, okay? And she said, Professor, we are getting reports from Tokyo. Who are you, the Pentagon? We are getting reports from Tokyo that people in Japan are very upset by the new Godzilla movie. I'd say, why? Is it, you know, anti-Japanese, you know, what's going on? He said, no, they're very concerned about the weight of Godzilla. He said, Professor, how big an issue do you think this is? I said, you know, it's not really global terrorism, you know? This is not something that we need to be losing sleep over at this point. And yet, this actually was something widely debated, that the American Godzilla was, in fact, obese. And got a lot of play for that reason. Now, fourth, despite all the changes in Godzilla's appearance and personality over the decades, he continued to embody certain universal values and character traits which audiences consistently found appealing. Notably, most of the movies came down to fairly easy stories of good versus evil. In the first movie, Godzilla is a threat, but in the later films, he really becomes a defender of Japan, a hero that audiences can root for. And this was borne out by the research I conducted on US fans of the series and putting together Godzilla on my mind. Godzilla's strength, the fact that he usually wins when he fights other monsters, and his good guy casting, this heroic image he portrays, are major parts of why American fans respond so positively to the monster. Fifth, Godzilla is, when all is said and done, pretty much just a big irradiated dinosaur from Japan. And the world, and especially children, it seems, have consistently just loved dinosaurs. The design of the original monster in 1954 was based on illustrations in Life magazine, pretty much the state of the art of what paleontologists thought dinosaurs looked like at the time, although the shape of Godzilla also had to reflect the need to fit an actor inside the heavy latex suit. In real life, a paleontologist named Ken Carpenter, who I've had the pleasure of meeting, named a fossil found in New Mexico, Godzillasaurus, in 1997, and has written humorously about Godzilla's potential place in a Jurassic ecosystem. So in light of all this, why do we still love Godzilla today? On the most basic level, I think Godzilla is just plain fun. The exuberance, the cheesiness, the cathartic nature of destruction, all are just enjoyable to watch, whether you're 6 or 60 years old. Godzilla is the outrageous guy that breaks all the rules and gets away with it. The walking disaster who leaves a trail of destruction behind him and inspires not just fear and loathing, but also admiration, awe, and an odd tingle of delight. Godzilla, in other words, has something of the Donald about him. And of course, as y'all know, Trumpzilla is sort of a thing. And if you go on the internet, there was almost infinite different incarnations of this. I also think that Godzilla, especially the very real Toho Godzilla, at least up until his 2016 outing, has appealed because he's an extremely human monster. Being a guy in a rubber suit is, I think, part of the fundamental charm of the series. It helps explain its success. Viewers can't imagine themselves more easily as Godzilla than as some kind of computer-generated creature because Godzilla moves like them. Godzilla is essentially human in form, and you can put yourself into his big, scaly feet stomping through toy sets. That there is a connection created between the viewer and the monster because of the man in the rubber suit that does not take place with so many monsters created by Hollywood today. But Godzilla also has a serious side, and I think one reason why we continue responding to him so strongly is because he has functioned as a cinematic conscience
for viewers throughout the post-war period. Godzilla's very presence, the disruption he presents to the status quo, and the existential threat the monster poses to our lifestyles, our comforts, our assumptions, and our complacency, keeps us asking questions we know we need to keep asking about issues like the environment, war, nuclear energy, arrogance, prosperity, modernity, and technology. And this is certainly the case in Shin Godzilla, the new movie, where the appearance of the monster creates this kind of cathartic crossroads moment for Japan, bringing down the old order and perhaps ending Japan's long post-war period, empowering a new generation to revitalize and rebuild the country. Finally, as I wrote about extensively in Godzilla on My Mind, I think what fires many fans of the Godzilla series, especially in this country, is a profound sense of nostalgia. And I've seen it for other countries as well. I've met a number of people from Latin America, Mexico, Brazil, who grew up like I did watching Godzilla on Saturday afternoons on TV, and their experience is remarkably similar to my own. Godzilla brings back memories of childhood, of an age when one could innocently watch movies with latex monsters beating up on each other, of a simpler, gentler time in the world when we didn't have to worry about global terrorism or Washington gridlock or global warming or killer bacteria. Godzilla reminds us of a youthful time when there are heroes in the world and we can draw clear distinctions between good and evil, and when we can laugh without cynicism at hokey special effects, dumb stories, bad dubbing, and a leading man with dorsal fins and big rubbery feet. On some level, loving Godzilla is all tied up with a misty-eyed yearning for the lost days of childhood and innocence and community and security. In the end, though, I feel what makes Godzilla so compelling for so many and so significant, not just for Japanese culture or American culture, but for contemporary global culture, goes somehow beyond the movie's longevity, ubiquity, topical relevance, and sentimental appeal. Godzilla distracts us and makes us laugh, as entertainment was meant to do. Godzilla challenges us to think and feel in ways that pop culture doesn't always accomplish. And the Godzilla films shine with a profound and genuine optimism that we all need more of in a complex, troubled, and unpredictable world. In the Godzilla movies, film after film, human society endures, Tokyo gets remarkably rebuilt, and the king of the monsters returns once again from the sea. On some level, of course, Godzilla is just a man in a rubber suit, or now in both America and Japan, just a bunch of pixels dancing on the screen. But I hope you'll agree with me that when all is said and done, the king of the monsters is truly something more. Thank you all very much. I mean, I think it's a really great question. You know, how has Godzilla spread Japanese culture in a positive way globally? Because there are many ways in which Godzilla has spread negative stereotypes of Japan. Because you think of the images that call up Godzilla movies in your mind, you know? Or maybe, you know, ask your parents to call up a Godzilla movie in their mind. And what do you get? A huge monster destroying a flimsy Japanese city, filled with terrified people, all very conservatively dressed, running away in horror, okay? So not only does this sort of reinforce the negative images we might have about the built environment in Japan, about, you know, it's inherently vulnerable, but also about Japanese people in the sense that they're physically small. It really underlines the smallness of Japanese. It's been sort of one of these great stereotypes of American perceptions since World War II. And I had the experience of being in Japan when 3/11 took place. I was in Tokyo, and I was on a bus with a delegation of Japanese Americans, and we were outside the new Ohtani Hotel in Tokyo. And I'll tell you, being on a bus when the big one comes, not a bad deal, okay? And so we just simply thought the motor was acting funny on the bus. Then all of a sudden we noticed the skyscrapers were moving like that, and people were running out of the buildings. Okay. So after it stopped shaking, the guy next to me, who's an executive of a power company in California, turned to me and said, "Bill, didn't that remind you of a Godzilla movie?" Horrifically bad taste, right? As we later knew, this could not have been in worse taste. And yet it did, right? It was this stereotypical moment of you're in Tokyo, the city looks like it's fallen down, and there are people in suits running everywhere. You know? And so I think Godzilla has put forward some negative stereotypes of Japan, to be sure. That being said, I think that that image of Godzilla as being something big and threatening and powerful also subverts some of those stereotypes of Japan. And I think probably this was in the thinking of the Japanese creators of the movie, that at this point in time, in the 1950s, and especially getting to the 1960s, we need a big hero for our country, okay? We need someone who can stand up for our country that's just recovering from the war and project a very positive image to Japanese themselves and to the outside world. And I think there's some of that positiveness that has transferred, especially perhaps to children overseas. And one of the cleverest things about the Godzilla movies is they can talk to people who are not perhaps sophisticated media consumers in a very immediate way. And I think for a lot of people, when we talk about why have things like anime and manga become popular in America from the 1980s on, I argue in my writing that one reason is because we were all attuned to Japanese tastes and conventions thanks to things like Godzilla starting in the 1960s. And so to me, that's a positive legacy, that Japanese aesthetics, Japanese storytelling conventions, and just the idea of Japan as a place that can be entertaining were set by Godzilla movies, moving into Speed Racer, moving into Astro Boy, you name it, in later decades. Great question. You know, so has the true meaning of Godzilla been lost, or how has it changed over time? And I think, you know, with something that has gone for as long as Godzilla has and remained as relevant as Godzilla has, you know, we're 60 plus years now that this film series has been internationally recognized, there's no one meaning left, you know? I do think that original message from the 1954 movie still resonates. And I think continues to resonate in our society, perhaps not as much in Godzilla movies as in other places. But that there are dangers that our arrogance as human beings causes. That we believe we are masters of the universe, that we, when we unleash something like the atom, that we can control it, and we can't. And we need to be a little bit more humble in how we deal with the unknown. The message there is being carried by global warming, by pollution, by food safety, by a thousand other related issues. So I still think it's vital in our culture and in popular culture. So Godzilla is not the messenger for that one, necessarily. Godzilla has gone on to become sort of a conscience for Japan and for the world, and for a creature that really allows us to address issues that are hard to talk about in public ways. Godzilla has allowed us to think collectively about topics that polite society finds it difficult to discuss. In Japan in the 1950s, boy, it was hard to talk about Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Of course, it had been censorship during the occupation up until 1952. You really couldn't write freely about the atomic bombings in Japan. And so, needless to say, people weren't used to just discussing this heritage. In later films, it continues to deal with issues that are hard for Japanese people to verbalize sometimes. So remilitarization is one of those. Nationalism is another one of very touchy issues in Japan today. And while I think the Japanese, my impression is Japanese are getting more open about talking about them, for a long time they were not. The Godzilla movies were one way that people could begin to explore those issues in a form that seemed unthreatening. Oh, it's a giant monster movie. You know, there's a big lizard in there. Surely that's not serious. But you know, in many ways, it is. And the most recent movie, have you seen the 2016 movie? You know, it really does talk about politics in Japan today in a meaningful way. If you're watching that movie and you're Japanese, you get the message, you know? The best thing that might happen might be a giant lizard comes and kills the whole cabinet. You know, that might be just what Japan needs right now. And it's funny, I happen to know a Japanese member of the Diet, and it turns out he's a government minister right now. I saw him last November. He said, Bill, did you see me? I said, what do you mean, did I see you? He said, there's a character in Shin Godzilla based on me. I said, what happens? He said, oh, he gets killed halfway through. It's great. You know, it's really an interesting question, because Godzilla is a shapeshifter, right? Godzilla is constantly changing. It was only really during the laziest days of the franchise in the 60s and 70s, where they'd reuse suits until they got totally worn out, that Godzilla looked the same for multiple movies in a row. But I do think part of this is that Japanese love of novelty. Japanese want to see new and different, improved and better things. And you can see that throughout Japanese popular culture. A series like Ultraman. Ultraman is still recognizable, you know, in terms of silver and red and, you know, the humanoid figure. But Ultraman has gotten cooler over time as well. So the Japanese just take it for granted that one of the big things about making a new Godzilla movie is what that look is going to be. And there's sort of an otaku thing about it, too, that everyone has their fantasy of what they'd like their Godzilla to be. So if you happen to be the person that gets chosen to direct and produce a movie, you get your shot to put your mark on the monster. And there is nothing as highly debated as that physical performance. I think one reason the Matthew Broderick film did so poorly is people just didn't recognize that as Godzilla. That strayed too far, you know, from our norms of what Godzilla should be. And that, you know, if even the 2014 Legendary Creature film was too fat and really got a lot of criticism for that, to me it wasn't a big deal, you know. And yet for a lot of fans, I think, this was a huge concern. It just shows, you know, how this franchise is sustained and re-energized. Yeah, it's a really good question because today, of course, we're used to that medium mix just being everywhere in Japan. The Japanese are the masters. That it's not just a movie, but you got to have the movie, the anime, the manga, the, you know, the whole range of products come out at once. Back in the 1950s, the Japanese were just beginning to pioneer this. It had not reached its full stride at that point. So there was, in fact, a Godzilla comic that came out, a manga, at the same time as the original movie. It is extraordinarily hard to find and grotesquely expensive today. Believe me, I would love to have it, but I cannot find it or afford it. But that, when you talk about that full range of products, you know, are there candy bars, are there whatever, and certainly like today, right, there's a Godzilla branded hotel in Tokyo. You know, that wasn't in place yet. But Godzilla was one of those proving grounds where it did take place. So you can find a lot of really fun Godzilla products, especially starting in the 1960s when that marketing machine, Japan becomes more commercialized in the 1960s, and that marketing machine picks up. There's a wonderful album of Godzilla-themed songs that comes out in the 1960s that is not to be missed. I play it with my car sometimes, just to feel happy. We've got, you know, Godzilla singing Christmas carols, you know, that defines